Okay, thank you. So we can proceed. So yesterday we looked at
terminologies. Yesterday it was here, right?
Yes.
Which one is better? This one.
Yesterday's.
It's better now, right?
Okay. It's better.
So yesterday we started by looking at terminologies that are used in modeling and evaluation. We looked at planning, also looked at what a plan is, we also looked at a goal, we looked at strategies, then what else are forgotten? My sister, tell us something. I've forgotten some of the things we covered yesterday. We also looked at approaches to planning, yes. We looked at approaches to planning and we discussed the top-down, the bottom-up and the mixed approach. And we did discuss the circumstances that are going to prompt you to use a particular approach, depending on the conditions, the time frame, as well as the resources. Those things should be able to speak to you for you to decide which approach of planning you're going to take. Then what else? We covered quite a lot. We also looked at a little bit on the history of monitoring and evaluation. Then what else we done? Want to say something? Okay. So today we are going to move on and define what monitoring is and what evaluation is. As you can see, monitoring and evaluation has got two things in itself. There's the monitoring aspect and there's the evaluation aspect, right? So even as we move on, we should be able to distinguish between the two, because monitoring is totally different from evaluation. Evaluation is totally dichotomous to monitoring and evaluation. But evaluation without monitoring, it can't work. We need to have something that we want to evaluate. And again, it would be impossible for us to monitor if we don't have a plan. Are we together? Okay. So before I can give my definition, is there anyone who can give it a try on the monitoring side? Or someone defined yesterday? Did we define what monitoring is?
Yes.
Sure. I don't remember. Oh, here, right? Okay. So, we've got the purpose of monitoring and evaluation. Why do you want to monitor something? Why should we evaluate something? So there are just these three major reasons. Number one, program improvement. And this is evaluation, the reason why we do evaluation. Remember yesterday when I talked about giving feedback to those people working on the project or those people that are implementing, right? You've done your evaluation and you've discovered that we did not meet our targets. Because always we are going to set our targets. After quarter one, we should achieve this, right? So through that process, now start doing the activities. Then it's now end of quarter one. We want to review quarter one, right? At an individual level, it's called more like performance appraisal. That's what evaluation is also is. You want to review how the performance of a certain employee or how the performance within the organization has been for the past one quarter. So once you discover that you did not meet your targets, evaluation will go further to ask, why did we not meet the targets? We have to know the reasons why we did not meet our targets, right? So now when we know that, when we discover the factors that, that stood as obstacles for us not to meet the targets, then we can always re-strategize along the process, right? We can always come up with new strategies. So in doing that, we are trying to improve the program. I even gave an example at lesson. Your target was to reduce HIV prevalence to 14, right? But if done the first year, then you've just realized that after doing the evaluation, HIV prevalence actually has gone up. Instead of 14.2, it's now at 15%. But your target is to reduce it. What do you do? Can you move forward doing the same things that you've been doing?
No.
The answer is no. So we need to do something different, right? So in doing that, we are going to improve the program.
Okay.
Then there is reporting and accountability. When the funders give us the money, they want to know who is responsible for what. Where is the money going? Are we reaching the target population? Are the people benefiting from this money? Are we together? Then we've got shared data with stakeholders. So at end point, maybe it could be the government. The government, they are also interested in the same indicators. You tell them that HIV prevalence now stands at 7.8%. Maybe they also want to use that data somewhere, to go and borrow money somewhere. Or maybe they want also to do planning. So these three things here, program improvement, reporting and accountability, shared data with stakeholders, are major purpose of monitoring and evaluation. The reason we want to monitor something is because of those three things there. So we move on to monitoring. I think there was a sister who sat here, and the mister there, they actually defined what monitoring is, right? Where we keep on tracking things on a daily basis. Whatever we are doing as a project, we have to document. Are we together? And it can only be possible for us to track something if we've got a plan. The plan is going to tell us what we are supposed to do on Tuesday. It's not just a matter of waking up and, okay, today now we have to start with vaccination. No, it has to be documented in the plan that on Tuesday, from 8 hours to 12 hours, it will be vaccination only. 14 hours, it will just be giving drinks to people. It should be there, and we should follow the plan. Otherwise, if we do something contrary to the plan, it's highly likely that we may not reach the targets, we may not attain the targets. The routine process of data collection and measurement of progress toward the program or project objectives. So we are talking about it. Routine collection of data, tracking what we are doing on a daily basis and recording whatever that we are doing. That's what we are saying, collection of data. Are we together? So now, we have to ask ourselves, which activities are we going to be tracking? What activities are we going to be tracking? So there are a lot of monitoring questions which you can answer. For instance, the first question there is talking about resources. Are resources coming in on time and being used as planned? Remember, you are going to have your monitoring and evaluation plan, right? Then beyond your monitoring and evaluation plan, you are also going to have a monitoring and evaluation work plan. So work plan, that's where you are going to document how much you need, who is going to be responsible for what. Everything has to be documented. Are we together? So in monitoring, we have to ask ourselves, are resources coming on time? Are we together? Then if resources are coming on time, are we using the resources as planned? Because it's possible, because you've seen the money today and you would rather do something differently, right? Which is totally different from what we documented in the plan. So monitoring will involve collection of data on the resources. Are resources coming in on time? If the resources are coming on time, are we using the resources as we planned? Are we together? Then the next question here is talking about activities. Are activities being carried out on time and on budget? Remember, when you do planning, which we are going to do, you are going to indicate that these are the activities that we are going to be doing as a project. Are we together? If it's procuring ambulances, you are going to document it in your plan. We are going to procure ambulances. Then after that, you are going to make the budget for the ambulances you want to procure, right? So here, you have also, as you are doing monitoring, as you are doing project implementation, at the end of each day, you have to ask yourself, have we done what we are putting there in the plan as activities? Are we doing those activities on time? Because it's possible that we had planned that vaccination will only happen on Tuesday, September 2019, right? Then because something is lagging, and today is the 3rd September, we've decided not to do what we had planned to do on this particular date, and we decide to do something else because We are lagging, right? So in monitoring, we need to address such questions. Are activities being done in time according to what we've put in the plan? And always when you're dealing with project, is what is called the Gantt chart. That's where now you are going to document everything from the start of the project to the end of the project. You have to document week one, this and this and this will be done. Week two, everything. So that would be more like a map, a guide, a compass. Are we moving according to the plan? Are we moving? Are we doing things within our budget line? It's also possible that we can go beyond, right? But if things have changed, for instance, like yesterday I gave an example of meal prices, right? We just realized that in our plan we have put 75, but now meal is now about 150 kwacha. So it means if you continue buying meal at 150 kwacha, definitely you are going to go beyond your budget line. So what do you do? You can always go back to your funders. The plane of the problem was, or due to political conditions or economic conditions beyond what we can control, we are going above our budget and we are asking for more. Are we together? Only in such conditions, but not where you've just decided to say, oh, since we over budgeted, so now we have to go back to the funders. Only when such conditions can be determined. Because even those people, they'll send people to come in Zambia to come and determine whether or not the pricing for millimeter has gone up, right? Though just this doctor was giving an example. He said he was involved in a project costing about 30 million British pounds in South Africa. So now, the people who were working on that project have committed to the government of South Africa that we are going to deliver this. Actually, they went far beyond the budget. Their budget was supposed to be 30 million British pounds, but they decided to make the budget over 35 million British pounds, hoping that they could go back to the British government to have that 5 million British pounds added on top of their budget. So now, along the way, it was past 3 years, they realized that if we don't go back to the British government and get that money, we are not going to finish this project. So they decided to go to the British government. Before they went to the British government, they decided to go to the South African government and tell them, actually, we overcommitted to what we're supposed to do. Is it okay instead of us delivering 10, we deliver 5 to you? The government of South Africa were very, very furious with the people that were working on the project. So now they resolved to go to the funders. Okay, well and good. Let's go to the British government and try to ask for the remaining 5 million. And what happened was that the project was cancelled and it was given to another company. So always work within your budget line. Don't commit. That's why there's the planning side of it, right? We need to plan according to the budget that we have. But if conditions have changed, which can be determined even by those people who are giving you money, it's possible that you can go back to them and tell them that these are the challenges that we are having at the moment. Hence, we are asking if our budget can be increased. Otherwise, if you remain seated when things have changed, when prices have gone up, it's likely that you are going to go beyond your budget line and you are not going to finish your project. Are we together? So we have to ask ourselves, are we doing the activities on time? Activities within the budget line. What is the quality of services being provided? We also need to ask ourselves. Everything is documented in the plan. These are the questions that will just help you to track what you're doing on a daily basis. But what's key for you, as I said, is what you put in your plan. And we are going to do that together. Then, are outputs being produced on schedule and on time? Always when we do something, we must see something coming out, right? Then output, we define them as the immediate results that comes upon doing something, right? For instance, if in our project, one of the activity was to do condom distribution, what could be the outcome? What could be the outcome? If in our project, our activity was to do condom distribution, what could be the output?
I think the prevalence of HIV and AIDS would reduce.
So that's the impact. So we've got the output, outcome, and impact. Then I'm saying output is something that you immediately see after doing something. So our activity, condom distribution, what could be the outcome? Yes, sir?
It is condoms distributed.
Sorry?
Condoms distributed.
Exactly. So by virtue of us distributing the condom, so it means that's the output. Then the outcome would be what? Outcome now is about behavior change. But it's very difficult to measure, especially the example that I've given to do with condom distribution. Because we need to be sure. Sorry? Yes, because the outcome would be people using the condoms, right? But it's very difficult to measure. It's very, very difficult to measure, right? The outcome is always the goal, which is reducing HIV prevalence, right? That's why, even as we start looking at frameworks, you see that as we move on from the left side going to the right side, even the number of indicators that we have keeps on reducing. In other words, as we move from here, like what happens most of the times, we lose influence, we lose autonomy, let's say impact. It's very difficult. But for the example that I've given, if you are dealing with HIV prevalence, it's very easy for us to measure the impact over the period of time, right? But outcome, it's very difficult to measure. Because the outcome would be, are people using the condoms? If you ask them, did you use that condom? Others will tell you no, others will tell you yes. So it's very difficult to measure because it's a sensitive topic, right? So always we need to ask ourselves, are outputs being produced? If yes, are those outputs coming on time? And the output is the immediate result of you doing something. For instance, if your activity was to conduct sensitization campaign, what could be your output? To conduct sensitization campaign on HIV. In Chivoya, yes?
Maybe increase levels of knowledge on HIV issues.
That's now outcome. That's outcome. The immediate results.
Or maybe 20 sensitization meetings held in Chivoya.
Exactly. That's the output. The immediate result of doing something. So we've done the sensitization campaign. What will be the result? People have been sensitized. Then now, the change in behavior will come in now when people have increased knowledge about HIV. So that will now become outcome. So there's output, then there's outcome in the middle here, and there is impact. Impact mostly, it is our goal, what we want to achieve at the end of everything. Then impact will happen in the middle here. People have been sensitized. That's the output. That's the immediate result of us conducting the activity, which is sensitization, right? So people have been taught. Then the outcome now will be change in behavior. Here we can assume that there is increased knowledge, right? Right? Then you can also have another outcome. If there is increased knowledge, what else? And we haven't started looking at the outcome and impact. I'm just going to tackle the definition for monitoring and for monitoring. Then there's also where you ask yourself, are we making progress toward our stated objectives? Remember, you're going to state your objective, and an objective just simply the statement of what you intend to achieve. To determine HIV prevalence, for instance, if it's in research, because in research we frame objectives, we frame process-based objectives to determine HIV prevalence. But in M1D mostly it becomes as a result objectives, where we're going to say 20% reduction in HIV prevalence. So here we assume as if things have been done already. That's how we state the objectives in monitoring and evaluation. So you can move on again. There are many questions here, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So those are the questions that you can ask yourself as you are doing the implementation. Then there's this Unfun question. What is being monitored? What is being monitored? So it can only monitor impulse activities and outputs. Only. Are we together? We can only monitor inputs, activities, and outputs. Are we together? We cannot monitor the outcome. It's very, very difficult. How can you monitor that people are using condoms, for example? It's very difficult. So inputs. There we are talking about resources. And actually, if I go back to my previous slide there, there was a question which was talking about resources, right? Are resources coming on time? If resources are coming on time, are we using the resources according to the budget or as planned? So we want to track how we are using the resources, part of monitoring. So every time when people go in the field, if we plan that a DM for each staff is 400 kwacha, it should be so from the onset until the completion of that project. We can't change along the way. We can only change maybe we've realized that actually the patch has depreciated. Instead of it being at 12.15 meters, now going to 18 kwacha per dollar. It means even if we give someone 400 kwacha and they are traveling to Zimbabwe, it will not be that enough for them because the kwacha has depreciated, right? If we planned in kwacha. But if we planned in dollars, well and good, it means everything is still okay. So we need to track our resources. We've got staff there. So the number of staff that we have is supposed to be tracked as well. Who is doing what? Have we placed people in the right position with the right skills? Because it's possible that the human resource manager can put someone here, but where someone has been put, they are ineffective and they are being inefficient because the skills that they possess and what they are doing do not correlate. So at end point, we have to ensure that if someone is good in software engineering, we have to put them there. We can't move the person who can do software engineering and we go and put them in banking, for instance. It's within, I'm talking about within the project. Are we together? Then we've got funds there. We are receiving funds. We need to know how are we using the money. So it is just related to resources there. Then we've got facilities. Facilities. Then we've got supplies there. Maybe sensitization. You need to have equipments like zip music. All those things. If you hire all those things, you need to track them on a daily basis. Then we move on to activities. There's an example there, facility construction, training. Someone gave me an answer that, so what did you say? I've forgotten. You said that 20 what? 20 sensitization meetings done. So that's coming on trainings, as we say. Those are, that falls under output, but those are activities. Oh, you said, okay, we are going to do facility construction, right? Then we are going to do trainings. As we start doing those trainings, we have to track what we are doing. Have we started doing the construction? Then when you move on to the output there, health facilities built. Facility construction and the output, if you started the construction, your immediate output will be what? A facility has been constructed, condoms distributed, trainings conducted. So those are outputs. Immediate the result of doing something. If I say I'm going to build the house, that's what I've said. That's my activity, right? So when I start, then my output will be that there's a foundation being seen somewhere. Are we together? I think this will make more sense when you start dealing with frameworks, because these things now, you have now to come up with a problem and start doing the framework. So that's why now all these things are going to make sense. So there are questions there. Why monitor? I'll go back there if I was to ask that question. Why should we monitor something? And actually we've discussed the answers. Why should we monitor something? Yes, my sister. want to know if the goals have been achieved. Okay, that's wonderful. Yes, sir.
Knowledge is accountability in the distribution.
We want to know whether or not there is accountability in the distribution of resources that we have. Wonderful. Thank you so much, sir. Sister, I wanted to say something. You can move on. We want to know whether we are moving in the right direction, right? We had planned everything. We had said that after the completion of the first quarter, we must see this. So we have to ask ourselves, have we achieved what we had planned to achieve in the first quarter? So we want to know whether we are moving in the right direction. To my left. Yes. So we want to monitor so that we've got data enough for us to come and do evaluation. We want to come and assess what we've done. Thank you so much, sir. Who else? Yes, sister.
Also know if we are moving within the time
frame. Wonderful, wonderful. We want to know if we are moving in a time frame. Remember yesterday when I talked about the time frame, but everything, whatever that we are doing as a project, even within the institutions, even within the ministries, there's something that comes up and we start doing as a ministry, but at some point, that thing should end, right? So it means as we are doing things, we have to be moving within the time frame. And that's why we do planning. Tuesday to be this, Tuesday to be this, this and this and this. So you have to be sure, are we moving within the time frame? So that's why we need to be tracking what we are doing. Are we together? You wanted to say something, sis? Exactly. We have to be sure that resources are not put to waste. Resources are supposed to be channeled into the right direction. We plan that we have to be doing condom distribution. Have we bought condoms? If we have not bought the condoms, where are the resources going? Because we've seen that now from finance showing that actually the money was reduced to procure condoms, that the condoms are not being bought. So monitoring answers such questions. And that's why monitoring and evaluation is very important. At any point in time, you come and know where there is a lacuna, where there is a gap. But actually, the money was released, but this someone here injected the money. But before then, people are just doing that. The project is for 10 years. They're just doing and doing and doing and doing. By the time they are reaching at the end of the project, and come and find that there is a 27 billion missing somewhere. But in monitoring, you are going to plan it. After 6 months, we have to sit down and review what we've been doing. Then from there, how much did we plan to spend? We plan to spend 700 billion. How much have we spent? We spent 1.7 billion. We are going to ask ourselves, why is there such a variance, such a difference? What happened? When you look through, you sit down, you come and verify, and you see that actually, the variance here from 700 million to 1.7 million, actually, the money went somewhere, not to what you had planned to do. Are we together? Then you're going to decide, should I fire someone who got this money? So it's up to you to decide as a project manager. Are we together? The director will decide. Or if it's the board who's got that mandate, they will decide whether to fire the director. Are we together? Monitoring is important for several reasons, but primarily what gets monitored is more likely to get done. If you don't monitor performance, you can't tell success from failure, and you just answered that. We need to know that we are moving in the right direction. Have we achieved what we've planned? If you can't see success, you can't reward it. If you can't recognize failure, you can't correct it. So that's why evaluation is there. Like we talked about sending feedback, right? So when you know that here there is a gap here, we did not do it as planned, or something has changed, we need to mend it. Otherwise, if we leave that problem going and growing and growing and growing, at the end of the day, we are not going to achieve our goal. And the people who gave us money will come in, tell us, what have you been doing? Where are we now? Because remember, in projects, mostly to be funded projects, right? They'll give you billions. Global Fund sending money to, is it a medical store? Of procuring drugs on behalf of the Zambian government. So they want to know. They'll go in hospitals and ask questions. The external evaluators will go there. Do you have drugs? Actually, the last time we had Parados, 2 weeks ago, where is the money? Because that's what we've released about 2 point something billion to the Zambian government. And the plan that we are given about at least 2 point something billion will cut off for the entire 2019. So the funders always come because they've given us money for a purpose, right? If you can't demonstrate results, you can't sustain support for actions. So we're moving into evaluation. Okay, we are going to answer this question, which is uses of information generated by monitoring day-to-day management, decision-making to improve program, advocacy, input to evaluation, someone have. Yes, sir.
I just want to get clear clarity on the difference between output and experience.
Okay, we'll come to that. So, output means the immediate results that you get upon doing something. Let's say you've eaten shino. What could be the output? What could be the immediate result or benefit of you eating shino? Sorry? You get full, right? Then the outcome, which will be now changing behavior, is what? Energy. Energy, right? Then impact. Impact. Listen. So the immediate result of us eating machine is to stomach relief, right? Then the change in behavior will be that we now have energy. If our goal of eating Ishima was to now start working, now it means I've got energy, now I can work. That would be now the impact of Ishima. Yes?
Yeah, so meaning I expected to serve as good as impact.
Exactly. So these are the uses of the monitoring data. Advocates, we know advocates speaking on behalf of someone, right? Because you've got valid data. Then you want to tell the funders that actually we've gone far beyond than expected. So is it okay if you can give us more money? But again, in project management, some of you are doing project management, right? Don't overexceed your targets. At least if your target was 40%, gone 45 is enough. Don't go on. You had planned to say 40% is what we intended to achieve. Then you go and achieve 90%. Even the funders will suspect something. Maybe it could be. These guys can just underplan for the sake of them making money. Because it's possible where you know that if I've been given 1 billion, then if I put my target at 40, then I'll look at the inputs, the resources that I'm going to put in here, and I'm like, okay, there will be 1 million extra, right? Then I'll say, okay, 40 is enough, so at the end of it, I also get it. So now you can imagine from 40, then you go and achieve 90%. So, target was to achieve 40%, but now you've worked far beyond your targets. Now you are at 90%. So then you're skeptical. Did they plan properly? It means when you go back to them to ask for more money, they will be very skeptical. So even as you exceed your targets, don't overdo it. The variance at least should be minimal. But anyway, depending again on what you are doing, it's possible because there are other people within the society doing what you are doing. So maybe it could be they also contributed. Instead of you maybe targeted 800 people, then the same people that you are teaching, maybe it could be another organization. Those people have been taught by another organization. So when they come to you, it's just more like they're doing a revision already. They know what to do. So by the time you just teach them, 2 days later, then you see the results. You see, okay, people are not knowing that there is another organization doing almost what you are doing as a project. Are we together? So don't overexceed. That's why planning is very important, because it sets the baseline for everything. It speaks to us as we move. Then we move on to evaluation. Before we can discuss the definition that we have in this PowerPoint, is there anyone from this class who can give it a try on the definition of evaluation? Evaluation, evaluation. You want to evaluate something.
Not,
yes, sister.
Not really a definition.
Okay.
But I think I would say it's an in-depth assessment of activities.
You say a detailed assessment of the activities. We are doing the activities, but we want to assess, we want to evaluate, we want to see whether those activities gave us the results we wanted. Thank you so much, sister. Well, our sister said, that's it. Evaluation. Okay, so we are going to discuss the statement which is here. So this definition is actually adapted. Oh yeah, I think put up, there's that person there, Michael something something. That person is from the United States. So monitoring, the first thing is, it's a process, right? So you know that the process is something that should happen at this stage, and it happens at this stage, and it happens at this stage. It's not a one day thing, right? That's why we said that the use of monitoring is really to act as an input for what? For evaluation. So it means evaluation starts as we start the project implementation. But there we don't see it being as evaluation. It's embedded within monitoring, because monitoring now gives us the data for evaluation. In other words, without data coming from monitoring, we can't do evaluation. Are we together? So it's a process of determining as systematically and objectively as possible the merit, value, or weight of an intervention. Being adapted from that diary, 1991, 4th edition. So now, there's a breakdown of this definition there. So the first thing that's talking about the systematic assessment of the operational outcome of the project program according to implicit and explicit standards as a way of contributing to the improvement of the program. That's another definition. Now the first thing there is talking about systematic assessment. Are we together? In a research, there are certain things that we are supposed to meet for us to say the research, or rather, how should I put it? Let me use an example of a survey, right? If I'm doing a survey, it means instead of me interviewing all the people in this class, I'll just sample, right? Then as I do the sample, if the 10 speak from this class, I can assume that the entire monitoring and evaluation class are spoken. Are we together? But the question that I'll ask myself is that, is the sample representative of the entire population, right? So for me to have a sample which is representative of the entire population, I have to use systematic ways. In this terms, it will be me applying the sampling methods available. Am I using the non-probability sampling? Am I going to use the probability sampling? So it means, even in evaluation, as we intend to evaluation, it's supposed to be systematic. Are we together? We have to use statistical methods for us to do a sample. You can imagine that the project was being disseminated, let's say, the intervention was in Vubui. We know that Vubui is big, so we can't go and interview everyone, right? But we have to draw a sample. So when we collect data from that sample, then we are going to do the analysis. Because we have followed, or we have used the statistical procedures for us to draw a sample, hence we are going to see our study was systematic. We are not just speaking, oh, sister, you are part of the study. Oh, sir, are you very busy? Not part of the study. No. But there are certain mathematical methods that are supposed to be performed for us to draw a sample. Hence, the way they are systematic assessment conducted according to social research procedure. So that's how evaluation is supposed to be. Are we together? So we are just dissecting the same definition here. So the first thing there we said is supposed to be a process, so it means it's not a one-day thing. Then, evaluation is supposed to be systematic, so it means we have to use the same social research procedures that are used. I know that some of you here have been doing research. There are certain research procedures that you follow. Don't just, okay, I'm doing a research now. First thing, I have to know what the problem is. Then for me to have a deep understanding of what the problem is, I'm going to review what others have done, right? Then on top of that, I'm going to do what is called the theoretical framework. I'm going to pick at least theories that will help me understand that particular social phenomenon. Are we together? Then after that, now I'm going to do the methodology. In the methodology, that's why I'm going to state the exclusion and the inclusion criteria. If I'm dealing with delicate scale kind of questions, I have to compute my clone batch alpha. I have to talk about the ethical consideration. We know that privacy is very important, so I have to address all those issues. And it means I'm following statistical procedures in my research. Are we together? Then the second part of the definition is talking about the operational outcome. So evaluation may concentrate on either the process, the way a program is being conducted, or the effect of the program for its intended beneficiary. So you are going to decide, depending on your intervention or on the project, are you going to focus in your evaluation on how the program is being conducted? Or is your focus on the beneficiaries? Are the beneficiary receiving what they are supposed to get, right? Or maybe it could be said, as we just want to assess how things have been going, have we been giving them? Giving them and receiving are two different things, right? So you can focus on giving. Are we giving the right people? Then on the other end, we can focus, have those people have been receiving, benefiting from what they're receiving? It's possible that we've given them, but we've not, what we've given them is not enough. We've decided to change along the way, just like it is in research. You've employed research assistants. Instead of them going in the field to collect the data, they just sit under the tree and fill out your questionnaire and give you the information. We are done with the data collection. So evaluation can either focus on how the process, how things are being implemented or being done, or it can focus on the beneficiaries. Are they receiving what they're supposed to receive? Then the last thing is talking about standard for comparison. Assess the merit or worth of the problem by comparing the evidence to set expectation. So set expectation is coming from where? From the planning side, right? We've determined, or we have put the targets that we want to give this and this and this and this to people. So evaluation now comes in. You want to do a comparison, but this is what we've planned and this is what we've achieved. Then you do the comparison between what you have, what you had said and what you've actually achieved. Then from there, you'll be able to tell whether you've met your targets or not. You've said to educate 10 people here, then here you've educated 6 people. Would you say you've succeeded? No, but at least 9, at least you can say we've done it. 9, we've given it a try, right? But not we've said 10 when we are at 2. So evaluation answers such questions. Then the last thing here, which is very important, contribution to the improvement. Evaluation is designed to make programs work better for the betterment of the beneficiaries. Before I can explain on this one, is there someone who can give us a try on what this statement means? Contribution to the improvement. And actually, there's a definition already. Evaluation is designed to make programs work better for the betterment of the beneficiaries. Is there someone who can give us a practical example for this one? Yes.
For example, I once had an experience with a child from the language where you help them with school fees and stuff like that. So as you evaluate, you're looking at the child in school, like the sponsoring the school fees, maybe shoes and stuff like that. So as you evaluate, maybe as you were monitoring, you were doing all this spot check to see if that child is in class, that child is wearing shoes, like you are saying, sometimes you give the the guardian those things, but they divert them to their own children. So now, as you're monitoring and assessing whether the child is receiving those things, that data will be available. You take pictures and do work, and then as you evaluate, you assess, you say, okay, what if these things have reached, have not reached the child, what have we been doing wrong in distribution? And you can assess either in the next year to adjust the distribution process to make it more efficient.
Thank you so much. So we have planned that we are going to be sponsoring these kids, and as we sponsor them, they're supposed to be in school, right? So now when we go in to do evaluation, just like the minister said, evaluation is going to give us information. Are those kids who are being sponsored in school? If let's say our plan... Yes? So the plan there was to ensure that we sponsor them, just not a matter of sponsoring, they are supposed to be in school, right? And our plan was that for the first 7 days, we need to see those 20 kids in school, right? Then we're going to do evaluation. And we discover that actually, in 7 days, we sponsored them, but only 3 kids are in school. So we must find out why. Where are the 7? We sponsored them, but where are the 7? When we discovered, actually, the man was released, but someone was in charge of giving out the money to these kids, or someone was in charge to pay the money to the school, has actually not paid that money. So we now know where the problem is coming from, right? So what do? We have to bend the problem. Are we together? And that's the importance of evaluation. It has to lead to the betterment of the program. Are we together? So in other words, evaluation will be, evaluation is meant to identify the gaps in what we've done before. Then as we identify the gap, now we come up with new strategies on how we are going to mend those lacunas. Are we together? That's the importance of evaluation. So I'll take you back to the definition. So we've talked about systematic assessment, we've talked about either concentrating on what is being done or the end benefits to the beneficiaries, then we are talking about doing a comparison between what we've achieved and what we had said, and we're also now talking about improving the actual program, right? So now let me take you back to this definition. What is the definition? Which definition can you do this? Okay, this definition. This definition. So, if we look at those 4 things that we've looked at, have we dissected the entire definition of evaluation? Have we? So, let's talk about the process of determining systematically, objectively as possible, the merit, the value, or worthy of an intervention. In the second one, you say evaluation and systematic assessments aimed at scrutinizing the program design. Scrutinizing the program design, so talking about contribution to the program, to the betterment of the program, right? Because we've now known what the lacunas are, so we can twist our program design implementation or results achieved against the range of criteria. So, systematic assessment, operation outcome, standard comparison, and contribution to the program. That's what we talk about when we talk of evaluation. So that's a full definition for evaluation. It has to be systematic. You need to look at how things were being done. You also need to do the comparison of what you've achieved and what you had said. And at the end of it, we need to give feedback to the program, to the people working on the project. Are we together? So there are so many types of evaluation. So we are not going to go into details. There is a front end analysis, which is the baseline evaluation. Evaluation conducted prior to the implementation of the program. Of course, there. Why is the baseline evaluation important for us? Why is the baseline evaluation very important? So the definition is there. The baseline evaluation is just simply the assessment that you do before the commencement of the program or the project. But why is that necessary for us? Yes, sister.
It is necessary because at the end of the project, you are supposed to see that where did we start from?
Exactly.
And where are we now? Right.
So we need to know where we're starting from. HIV AIDS now is 14.2%. So this is the best thing. So it means we are beginning here, right? You can proceed, sister.
Yes, so it gives you that
Overview of what the landscape of the problem is now.
Yeah, to show whether you problem.
Exactly. Sister, I wanted to say something. Is it you? Yes, sister, yes.
I'll pass.
You pass. So that's the importance of doing the baseline study. We need to know where are we now. Are we together? Once we know where we are now, along the process, when we reach here, we can now confidently speak. If HIV prevalence has reduced to 7%, we can confidently reduce that. When we started, HIV prevalence was at 14%, but now we are at what? 7.8. Now you can imagine if you did not have such an indicator, how are you going to say that we've contributed to the reduction of HIV prevalence? It's not possible because we are telling you that actually even when you started, HIV prevalence was at 7%. In fact, it was even at 5%, you've increased it, right? So that's the importance of us doing the baseline. We have to understand the landscape of the problem. We need to know where we are now. So that as we begin to do things, our baseline stands like a beacon here, that's where we are. So that as we move forward, then once we reach at a certain point, we need now to compare what where we have started from and where we've reached now. Where we are going to reach and where we started, the difference there is going to tell us whether we've made it or not. Are we together? So the need assessment is very important, and this can be almost be equivalent to just the actual research. The actual research where you want to understand what the problem is, then from there, you are going to say that, okay, HIV AIDS is now at 14%. Then, once you have the baseline here, now it will be possible for you to set the targets. Are we together? Once you have the baseline, you have where you are standing now, it's possible that, oh, okay, I've got 20,000 this year, and I'm going through this business. So my target after 2 years is that I have to have 70,000. Are we together? Then, as I move on 2 years later, I'm going to be the most. If I'm at 15%, then I know that I did not grow in this business. What do I do? I have to change that business. So maybe it could be the business is good, but I haven't just been stocking what I'm supposed to put in my shop, right? So the baseline is very important. You conduct that before the actual implementation of the program. It will help you to set your targets. But if you did not have that indicator there, how are you going to set your targets? It will be very, very difficult for you.
Question.
Yes, sir.
Is it possible to also look at other players that are doing the same thing in the same program?
Exactly. He's asking, the minister is asking, is it also possible to look at other players who are doing exactly the same thing? That's why now, in evaluation is what we call attribution and contribution. You need to be very sure when HIV prevalence has reached at 80%, there are certain metrics that are supposed to be computed for us to be very sure. Actually, we contributed to this. There are other players. There is the government, there's UNICEF, for instance. There is the USAID. And they say, has we are global fund, we need to be sure. So at the end, we are going to come and do what is called contribution and attribution. That's why in my last lecture, we are talking about evaluation just pure. I want to dive into evaluation because evaluation is very, very, very cardinal for all of us. That's why I said we are going to include a little bit of statistical analysis so that now we compute now in percentages. Then from there, we should be able to tell how much do we contribute to that reduction in HIV prevalence. It's possible that maybe whatever that we did not even contribute to that. Maybe we did something else, but we can be celebrating. No, actually, HIV prevalence has reduced to 7.8, so we need to be sure. Is it us who have led to this reduction? But it's very, very complex to measure because that's impact. A long term, there are other prayers. There are other prayers. That's why most organizations will just end up measuring the outcome. Because impact is very costly. You need to invest in a lot of money for you to measure. So most of you will just end up changing behavior of people. So once we have just established here, we can assume that actually we've contributed. What will happen to the impact, they don't care. Whether it has reduced, they just assume that, actually, as we did the activities, we had the outputs, and we saw that there was change in the perception towards HIV/AIDS. And the end there, the project is done. But now if you are also interested in the impact, money again is an issue. So you can do the formative evaluation, the midterm evaluation, impact or outcome evaluation. So it's up to us in our plan, as we begin doing the planning, we are going to agree. Are we going to conduct a midterm evaluation? For instance, if the project is designed for 5 years, so we are going to agree, okay, we are going to be doing evaluation every after 1 year, right? So that we assess what we did in that past year. Okay, we're going to say, okay, well and good. The first evaluation will be after the period of 2 years. It's up to us to decide. Are we together? Then at the end of it, you decide which kind of an evaluation you're going to do. Do you want to do an impact evaluation, though very expensive and very difficult to measure? Then do you want to do an outcome evaluation? For instance, in distribution of condoms, right? Is it possible for us to do an outcome evaluation? An outcome evaluation would be that people are using condoms. So it would be very difficult for us to know whether or not people are using condoms, right? So it means we can just end up at measuring the outputs that actually people received the condoms. Because it's difficult for us to measure whether or not people are using condoms. So there are certain topics that are very sensitive and to limit your assessment. You may even end up to outputs only. Are we together? Then after maybe the period of 5 years, then the Central Statistics, after doing the census, they report that HIV prevalence has reduced, and they are going to celebrate that actually you also distributed the condoms. So summative evaluation, just from the word itself, it comes at the end of everything, right? I'll give you the slides. Then there's focus evaluations, compares expected or planned targets with the achieved results or accomplishments. And actually, this was in our definition, right? When we talked about the comparisons of the set expectation and what we've achieved now. So it's up to you to choose what you want to do. Are we together? Do you want to focus on how the implementation goes? Do you want to focus on the resources alone? There's such common terms like cost. Is it cost effectiveness, right? This is also another form of evaluation. I'm not interested in the results. For me, I just want to know the cost effectiveness. As what else do we have under the cost effectiveness? There's cost utility analysis. Other people are not concerned about your outputs, they're not concerned about your outcome, they're not concerned about your impact, but for them, they are going to use this as an indicator. Are we together? So it's up to you to choose. We want to do a costive utility analysis, you are going to decide. Maybe you know that doing an impact evaluation is going to cost at $1 million. And doing this will just cost about $50,000. So it means this one is much better than that one. So depending on the results that you're going to get here, then you can assume that we've made it, right? Because here we are going to plan. You know, these are the 5 tenders we are going to procure with these and these and these and these specifications. Full stop. So at the end of it, when we procure, So we need to come and do the cost utility analysis. Do we procure things according to the specification? So you are not interested in the results, how those things are going to be working, but you are interested in the specification, right? So it's up to you to decide which evaluation you want to do. How do we know we got the evaluation focuses when comparing the expected or planned targets? Everything is going back to the plan, right? That without the plan, it would be impossible for us to do the comparison of what of where we are now. And that plan is also what we've just discussed, the baseline. We need to know where we're starting from and where we've reached now, we do the comparison, right? Other key question that evaluation should address: to what extent have the objectives been met? By how much? How? Why? So here now, it takes us to the indicators which we are going to do later on. To what extent? So it means to the extent they are, it can be numerical, we can quantify that thing, right? So it means we can set an indicator which is a quantitative indicator, something that can be measured numerically. Are we together? Then there is by how much can we measure it quantitatively or qualitatively? We can measure the magnitude quantitatively, right? Then how and why? The why there definitely it can't be numerical. It's supposed to be in a narration, right? What changes in the target group can we associate with or attribute to the problem? So is it the Mr. Bell asked? Is it yourself? We're talking about, someone asked the question when I was talking about the, when I talked about the contribution and the attribution. Who asked that question? Is it you? That's about 5 minutes ago. Exactly. So now, what changes in the target group can we associate with or due to the program? So we want to measure. You know that HIV prevalence has reduced, but we want to measure how much did we contribute to that reduction. Because there are other players doing the similar things that we've been doing. So we want to quantify by how much did we contribute to that reduction. Has the program been effective? When you talk about effective, we are talking about speed in terms of time, right? Am I correct? Effectiveness is measured in terms of time. We are being effective. So it means maybe if you plan to finish your work at 15 hours, you finish your work at 12 hours, it means you are being effective. And if you are being ineffective, it means the plan was to finish the work in 7 days and you are taking 1 month. Then efficiency, we are talking about usage of minimal resources, but we are getting optimal results, that efficiency. So has the problem been efficient? So that's what I'm talking about, the cost effectiveness. Others, they could go for a cost utility analysis. It's up to you as an institution, as top management, to decide. Are we together? And in the project, if you're working with projects and programs, the standard, the minimum budget that you're supposed to allocate just specifically for monitoring and evaluation, at least is supposed to be 15%. Are we together? At least 15% of the budget that you have, 15% should go just for monitoring and evaluation. Because without monitoring and evaluation, at the end of it, we are not going to tell whether or not that project succeeded. Are we together? So I'll give you the slides. So differences between monitoring and evaluation. So we can discuss this before we can look at the slide. So we've discussed that monitoring is just actually routine tracking of the activities that are being done. Are we together? But evaluation, we are talking about assessing what has been done in a nutshell. So what could be the differences between evaluation and monitoring? Yes.
Monitoring is an ongoing process.
Ongoing process, a routine, something that keeps ongoing.
Well, this evaluation is
once off. It's periodical, right? They are very much like this one, is a continuous process. And the other one, you have a particular point in time. depending on what you are putting in front of you, immediate evaluation. How it goes. Thank you so much, sir. What else, sister? What else, sister? Delta, monitoring spontaneous, once off, time specific. This one is frequent, evaluation is rare. Focused on present and future, focused on past. Who can justify a point the bullet which is focused on past? How is evaluation focusing on the past? How possible is it that evaluation? Yes, sir. Okay. So it means you're assessing what has been done, right? Exactly. Then focus on outputs, and that one, evaluation. Telling us evaluation will focus more on the end result of what we've been doing. Then internal, then that one, that side is what? So I have a question. Why is it that evaluation mainly is supposed to be external as opposed to internal? Exactly. So we are trying to avoid some biases, right? Let's say you're working on the project. Whether or not the project succeeded, let's assume that the project did not succeed, right? Then you are the same person evaluating the same problem. What you did, you are going to manipulate numbers so that you report that the project succeeded. So mainly, evaluation is supposed to be external. Now let's assume that we've got an internal evaluation team. What's the major function of the people within? So it's more like the way companies are. There's that department, which is it auditing? Sometimes there's internal auditing within an institution, right? And sometimes the institution hire the external auditors. But what are the functions of the internal audit department within the institution? To correct the problem right there, right? Before the external auditors are in, right? So even in evaluation, you can have the internal evaluators within to tell us that actually we did not do it rightly. And why? It's because of this and this and this and this. Can we quickly mend on this? So that at the end of the program, World Health Organization, before they send their external evaluators, so there are times where evaluators who come from Europe, others who come from America, others who come from within the country, but you don't know those people. They'll come to evaluate what you've been doing. They'll look at your records. They'll go to Central Statistics. Can you give us this information? The team that were working on the project, can you give us the information? Then they'll verify, then they'll write the feedback that actually not much was done in this project. So it means next time when you go back to ask for money, they will not give you money. Are we together? Then it ends there. So those are the differences between monitoring and evaluation. So M and DCC refers to the structure totality that an organization has set up for carrying out the M and E function. This involves the totality of data collection, storage, and analysis. So when you talk about M and D system, it's a circle. It's a circle like this. So here, we are going to have collection templates. We need to give the templates that we are going to use for us to collect data. Are we together? Maybe it could be developing questionnaires. We have to develop questionnaires and standardize them according to the company. Are we together? It doesn't make sense every time we want to do an evaluation, we are designing new tools. So that are we designing them, right? For instance, I'll give an example of sensors. Sensors, they have got the same questionnaire that they used in 1969, when they conducted the first census in Zambia, the only thing that they did to that question is that if in 1969 they did not collect data on ethnicity, now in 2020 they want to collect information on ethnicity, they will just add that to the questions. But the questions will still be the same for these other variables. So it means even us, we should be able to build the data collection tools. Once we build there, we must have people there, because these tools, they can't work on their own, right? There must be people somewhere. Are we together? And that's why it is being called a system. It means it's a composition of a lot of things. You know that a system is made up of different things, right? But all those different components function for a single purpose, right? So it means even in evaluation, as we are trying to build an M&D system, we need to build this. We must have people somewhere who are using these tools. We must have people just looking at funding. It's possible that we've developed this, but we don't have money. Are we together? Then after doing that, we must have the people also collecting data here. Once we collect data here, analysis at some point should happen, right? When analysis, what comes after analysis? What will come after analysis? Reporting. So even when it comes to reporting, we must have reporting templates. Yesterday I was saying that institutions or organizations like USAID, for instance, they will even give you reporting templates. Means as you do your things, or what you do, it's just to populate in their reporting templates. It means if you give them your report in a different format, they are not going to accept it, because they have already predetermined for you your reporting templates. So this is what happens when you say building an M&D system. It's a system which has what? A lot of components, but all of these components, they work for a single purpose. That's like the way the human body is, right? You know that there are cells, it's this and this and this, but at the end of the day, you have to make sure that at least there is a human being like who is working and breathing. So, even when it comes to developing M&D systems, it's very complex, and you are not going to, you can't do this alone. Are we together? You can't build an M&D system alone, no. You need also to engage people outside your organization. That's why you are going to be having workshops. You are going to decide, okay, let's build the data collection tools. You format your questionnaires. Then from there, as an organization, you're going to say, okay, we're going to be a committee just specifically for financing. Are we together? So that's why in the definition is talking about that an M&D system is a structural totality that an organization has set up for carrying out the M&D function. And I said all those compositions just for a single purpose, and the purpose is just for M&D function, which we've talked about, the monitoring and the evaluation side of it. These are the components of the M&D system. We've got organizational structure with M&D, human capacity for M&D. I talked about people somewhere with the M&D plan. If you are going to have time, you are going to do an M&D. An M&D plan is quite detailed. You can even go up to 42 pages and post an M&D work plan. That one should be very simple to all of us, right? Where is sensitization, M&D program also involved, how much is going to be spent, the date on which that is supposed to be done, that's a costed M&D work plan. Then we've got M&D advocacy, communication and culture, routine program, monitoring, survey and surveillance. That's where now the issue of research comes in there. Then we've got M&D database. How are we going to be keeping our information? Are we together? It's also very important. We don't want the data that we have to leak to the public domain, because there could be something, we are looking on HIV, we know that the information on HIV is very confidential, right? So we want to be keeping, so we have to do everything. Supervision and data auditing is going to be working on the data, evaluation and the research, dissemination and data use. So all those are the composition of an M&D system. So it's quite details and complex, and that's why you can't do this alone. You need to do it as an organization. You are going to engage other people from outside. Are we together? The M1D plan, I think this one is very simple, right? It's just a document that is going to show whatever that we are planning. We'll do this. These are more just like terminologies. M1D work plan, actually, there is an example. This is familiar to all of us, right? What's the time? Are you within the time? Okay, any questions on what we've discussed today? Any questions? Yes, sir. Exactly. So the activities can be twisted a bit. So once you've done evaluation, you've noticed that some of the activities actually that were being done are irrelevant to what we intend to achieve. And you can discard off such activities because they're not reading us where we want to be after 5 years. So you can discard them off. But what I know that all the activities cannot change, it means that the point of doing the planning, you did not plan well. It's not possible for you to change all the activities along the way. It means something is wrong from the planning aspect. So yesterday, now we'll move on to start now looking at the frameworks. So I'll share the slides with you so that you can go through. Because the same thing that we've discussed, the goal, the targets, is what we are going to be dealing with. As you can see, for example, this one. Which one? For example, there is a goal. We need to know what a goal is. We need to know what the purpose is. We need to know what an output is. So it's looking to be very, very simple like this, but these are the documents that we need for us to do monitoring and evaluation. Because this comes when we are doing the planning. Are we together? But I'm not. Which group are you in? About if I'm there. I wanted to post specifically in the WhatsApp group where only all of us who are here in that group, not those who are not paid up members. Emmanuel is going to create a group. Okay, I'll ask him so that I can post the slides there. Or if possible, now you've got a flash. No, I can put just now. Any questions on what we've discussed today? Have we understood what we've discussed today?